So, I will talk about the phase transitions of water particles. I mean, the phase transition of water is well known to us all. We all know that at 0 degrees Celsius, there's the melting transition. So at lower temperature, we have water ice. At higher temperatures, we have nice liquid water. The question is, what happens if you go now to very small particles, so nanoparticles, clusters? At what time will they show this kind of transition? And this is a question which could be of some relevance, for example, for the atmosphere, because in the atmosphere or even out of space, you have lots of water particles. And the question is, are they liquid? Are they solid? I mean, they play quite a big role in the atmospheric chemistry, so the state of aggregation should matter. So that is something we wanted to find out. So in my talk, I will give a little bit more motivation, then I will briefly explain the method we are actually using to investigate the water particles. Then I will show some results we have obtained quite some time ago on metallic clusters, sodium clusters. They turn out to be very simple systems. And then we have been working on water clusters, and this seems to be quite more complicated, as we will see. We have now come up with a simple model which tries to explain what we're actually seeing, and maybe I can convince you that there's some truth in it. So first of all, before one starts experiments, one can have a look in the literature. The melting temperatures of water particles have not been measured before, but there have been a lot of calculations. And this shows here a prediction of melting points as a function of cluster size. And you see the predictions are all about the temperature range, which is maybe not surprising because water is actually very difficult to treat theoretically. I mean, usually you use either empirical force fields between the water molecules or DFT or something, but these even predict the melting temperatures of bulk ice not correctly. So the well-known force field tip 4P predicts 232 Kelvin bulk ice melting temperature. A more complicated one, this TTM something predicts 240, and DFT with a PBE functional predicts even 417 Kelvin, so they are far off. So it's no real wonder that also many simulations are off. There are some experiments on small water structures, not on clusters or nanoparticles, but on water in pores. There have been lots of experiments on water in porous materials. And so one knows that the melting point of this water goes down if the radius of these pores goes down. But if you have to get the water into these pores, so they're usually cylindrical. But the melting point just depends on the surface to volume ratio. So you can rescale this results on the cylindrical pores to spherical particles. So this would be kind of the experimental prediction for the melting point of water particles. Now, there's actually better, newer calculations on, for example, by the Molinero group, who have calculated water clusters using a funny model. That's MW model. This is modeling water molecules as silicon atoms, basically, because they prefer this tetrahedral environment. But this model is very good in predicting the bulk melting point of water. And they got now for water clusters. They saw that these water clusters in their model always has a little crystalline core and some amorphous water around it. And the melting point of this crystalline core, the size dependence of it is shown here, and it fits perfectly to this kind of expectation which one gets from this cylindrical pore experiments. So this is something one would now think that this is a good prediction for water clusters. But let's look at the experiment. So how do we measure these melting points? We use photofragmentation of size-selected clusters in the gas phase to measure the internal energy of the clusters. We use the size-selected cluster, for example, sodium 147, and then we irradiate it with light. It absorbs light, the cluster heats up and evaporates atoms, and then we measure the size of the fragment which is produced. And the hotter the cluster is, the more atoms it will evaporate. So if you increase the temperature of the cluster, these fragment groups shift. This here are measured fragment distribution as a function of the cluster temperature. And you see they shift, and then at some point they jump, and this is actually the melting temperature. But you can evaluate this time-dependent photofragment distributions and get out a caloric curve, which is shown here. So this is a caloric curve, the internal energy of the cluster as a function of its temperature for a psi-selected sodium 139 plus cluster. And you can see here the dots. This is without any free parameter. We do absolute measurements. And you see here for low temperatures, there's a linear increase. If you just take the slope of it, this is the Dulong-Petit value, matches perfectly. Then at very low temperatures, you see that the slope gets down to zero. This is this quantum mechanical freezing out of the vibrational degrees of freedom. You can fit a Debye temperature to it, and it's actually very close to the bulk Debye temperature. And then you see this jump here. There in the cluster in a very small temperature range gets a lot of energy from the heat bath, and this indicates the melting, and then it's liquid and has a constant heat capacity anymore. Up here, it starts to evaporate. So from this, you get out the melting point and the latent heat of melting, which is just the step height. Then one can look at the size dependence of it. We did this for many sizes, and you can see both the melting point, these are the white dots, and especially the latent heat of melting, which are the red dots, they show very strong size dependence. And of course, if you know these two values, then you can also calculate the entropy of melting just by taking the ratio. These are the blue dots. And you see they have pronounced maxima, especially the latent heat here and the entropy. And this we can now relate to the structure of the clusters because we did independent photoelectron spectroscopy. We work on it from on these clusters from which we could detect their structure. And we can see whenever a cluster has a very nice symmetric structure, it's very hard to melt, so it needs a lot of energy to melt. And of course, the entropy gain upon melting is also very high. So that is pretty easy to understand. And now we wanted to see how is it with water clusters. First, a few words about the experiment, how we do it. In all cases, we produce the cluster with a so-called gas aggregation source, liquid nitrogen tube. Cooled tube through which gas flows with a pressure of about 1 millibar, typically helium or argon. And then we evaporate the cluster material into this cold gas stream. Clusters form, and we have a weak gas discharge which charges the clusters. We need charged clusters because we want to do mass selection. So the clusters coming out of the source are inserted into a radio frequency trap where they're stored for a short time for thermalization, and then they're inserted into a time of flight, double reflector, time of flight mass spectrometer, where we can use a mask scale to cut out a certain size. And then we have an interaction region where we can irradiate it with a laser. And then the photo fragment distribution is analyzed with the help of the second reflector. Just one word about this radio frequency trap we use for the thermalization. It's based on the design by Dieter Gerlich. It's a radio frequency trap attached to a cold head, which can be cooled down to 6 Kelvin or heated up to 400 Kelvin. And this, with the help of a little bit of buffer gas of helium, we can use to thermalize the clusters. In doing this thermalization of trapped ions, a lot of things can be done incorrectly. So one can easily get radio frequency heating and get much too hot clusters. But now, because we have this very sensitive caloric curve, we can actually measure the temperature of the clusters and compare them to older measurements. And we see that caloric curves measured with a radio frequency trap agree very nicely with measurements done earlier with other methods. So we are sure that with this radio frequency, we can really set the temperature of the cluster with a precision of better than 1 Kelvin. So we have done this now to water clusters, in this case, negatively charged water clusters. I mean, we need charged clusters in order to manipulate them. Also, the cluster needs some kind of absorption. So in order to do the photofragmentation, and negatively charged water clusters fulfill these two properties, and then we get this photo fragmentation patterns which we, shift again with temperature. So we can use this now to get out caloric curves. And one can see here two examples. These are two caloric curves of water clusters with 48 atom molecules and 118 molecules, and they are compared to the caloric curve of bulk ice, which is the dashed curve here. You can see in the lower part, there's a very good agreement between the cluster curves and the bulk curve, and then the cluster curves suddenly deviate from the bulk curve. They are steeper, so there obviously is an opening of channels which take up more energy. So obviously bond breaking is taking place. So, but it doesn't look as nicely step-like as you see it for sodium clusters. So it's more a smeared out transition. So it was not really clear what happens, but it must be something related to melting. But we wanted to understand this in more detail, so we did a lot of measurements on different sizes of negatively charged water clusters, but we also did other dopings. So we put in, for example, protons, protonated water clusters, or we put in negatively charged oxygen atoms, or even we tried to get as close as possible to neutral clusters. So we put in positively charged aniline molecules, because here the positive charge sits on the benzene ring, which is always outside of the water cluster, so just like an antenna, and the NH2 group takes part in the hydrogen bond network of the water cluster, so this is maybe as close as you can get to neutral water clusters. And then we measured all this transition temperature, so the temperature at which this deviation of the caloric curve from the bulk caloric curve sets in. You can see there's some size dependence for the negatively charged water clusters or for the oxygen-doped water clusters. There's practically no size dependence for the aniline-doped water clusters, and the protonated ones are a little bit higher. Not only we are doing these measurements, we have colleagues in Toulouse, the group of Pierre Labastide and Germain Lhermitte. They did also similar measurements using a different method. On protonated and deprotonated water clusters, the results are here. These are, again, the transition temperatures. For small sizes, you see a lot of variation. And then for larger sizes, they again seem to converge against the temperature, which we also saw for our larger clusters. Now, we can summarize these results and compare them to the theoretical prediction. And it doesn't really match for us. It seems that the transition temperatures we are seeing are more or less converging against something like in the range of 140 Kelvin instead of going up here. But this is not a big surprise because, as I told you, these calculations have been done just looking at the crystalline core of the cluster, not at the melting of the outer, more or less amorphous shell, whereas we are working here in a size range where there is actually no crystalline core, so we are kind of looking only at this more or less amorphous shell. Now the question is there something special about this temperature here around 140 Kelvin? And in fact, there is. This is the glass transition temperature of amorphous ice. Just a few words about water. This is a funny face diagram of water. It doesn't show all the crystalline phases of water, but just the non-crystalline ones. So up here you have liquid water, then below 0 degrees Celsius you can have supercooled water. I mean, you need something like crystallization seeds for the crystallization to set in. If the water is very clean, you can supercool it, but then at minus 38 degrees Celsius or so, it spontaneously crystallizes. There's no way to cool further down. But you can produce very cold water by producing amorphous ice, by crushing normal ice with high pressure, for example, or by evaporating water onto a very cold surface. And this very cold amorphous ice then shows a phase transition, or something like a glass transition at 136 Kelvin, converts into ultra-viscous liquid water, and then spontaneously freezes at about 150 Kelvin. Now this has been looked at a lot, but there was a big discussion whether this glass transition actually happens, because the effect on the heat capacity at the glass transition is very small. So this is the heat capacity as a function of temperature of bulk water. You see this amorphous ice, and then there's this tiny bit of an increase of the heat capacity, and then it drops because the spontaneous crystallization sets in. This gets much more clear if you put some salt into water. And even a very small concentration, so lithium chloride with a concentration of one molecule per 75 water molecules, changes the situation enormously. If you produce an amorphous ice of such a solution, then you see then there's a large jump of the heat capacity at this glass transition temperature, and then you can follow it also this higher heat capacity for a large temperature range. Now our curve looks like this. We always have this kind of strong change, and one can maybe understand this. We do not have a high salt concentration in our clusters, but we have the surface. And the influence of salt in the water or of a surface on a water particle is that they both disturb the formation of a nice crystalline structure. So our water cluster structure is probably closer to those of this bulk water with some ions in it. Now, just a word about what actually is a glass transition. If you have any material and it's at high temperature, it's liquid. If you then decrease the temperature, then this is the energy or volume or whatever. But let's say it's energy, so the energy goes down, and then at the freezing transition, it drops a lot, and then you have the solid, and then the energy goes down because of the heat capacity of the solid. Now, if you manage to supercool it, then the energy goes lower and lower, but it still stays liquid. But at some point, then the molecules kind of block and don't move anymore, and then you have a solid. But it's a non-crystalline solid. And there's not just one non-crystalline solid, but there's an infinite number of different structures which can have rather different energies. And in which structure you end up is very much dependent on the cooling rate. So if you go very slowly, you can end up in a lower energy state. If you go cool very fast, you can end up in a higher state. So there are two characteristics of a glass transition here. One is there are many, many states which can be solid states in quotation mark, which can be populated, and everything depends on the cooling rate. Now, what about our clusters? Do we have different structures? Yes, we know this from spectroscopy. For example, we did photoelectron spectroscopy, and we see always a broad peak, but not only one, but several broad peaks, and they are actually caused by different geometric arrangements of the water molecules. And we cannot get rid of this different isomers. Here we are seeing, even if we try to anneal the clusters at medium temperatures and cool them very carefully, we always see a superposition of several isomers, which obviously shows that if you cool down the clusters at some point, they get frozen in some non-equilibrium state. But it's even much more dramatic if you look at water clusters. I mean, water clusters usually don't have very nice structures, but there are some sizes where you can think of them of having a very nice geometric structure. For example, there's a magic size 50 for negatively charged water clusters or 51 for neutral water clusters. And the structure probably is this one. A very nice star with seven tips, so unusual structure, but looks very stable. But these are just the oxygen atoms. Now, of course, you have for every oxygen atom two hydrogen atoms, and you have to put them in here, but each hydrogen atom you can put either to the left oxygen atom or to the right oxygen atom. Of course, in the end, there have to be two hydrogen atoms per oxygen atom, but there's a lot of variability here. And this is known, for example, for bulk ice. In bulk ice, you have this proton disorder, so the protons are not always placed in one way. So you get a residual entropy of 3.5 joule per mole Kelvin for this disorder in bulk ice. Now, you can do a back of the envelope calculation using this value for this cluster. And then you see that if you have 51 molecules, you will have not one structure here, but because of this variability of the hydrogen placement, you have something like 2 billion different structures. Now, many of them will be kind of similar. You can transform them by symmetry operations, but certainly there will be several million isomers for this one arrangement of oxygen atoms. And for most sizes, we have not one arrangement of oxygen atoms, but many. So there's almost a continuous density of states of different structures for water clusters, very unlike to the case of metal clusters. Then we can also do observations which seem to have to do with the cooling rate. I mean, I showed you the caloric curve of water 48 minus, but we have measured this several times. Many times, actually, and sometimes we get a curve which is very close to that we have published, but sometimes we get also different curves where the energy is much higher at low temperatures. Of course, there can be many artifacts. There are many ways how one can make clusters too hot, but this is pretty, even if we put a lot of effort into it, we see something like this. And there's also something funny. You see here at this low temperature, the slope is almost zero. So this means that here suddenly the heat capacity of the cluster seems to be lower than that of the bulk. But this would only be possible if the frequencies, the vibrational frequencies of the cluster would be much higher than that of the bulk, and this is not possible. I mean, usually there are lower frequencies in the cluster than in the bulk. And not only we are seeing this, also our colleagues in Toulouse are seeing this. This is now heat capacity curves. They're measured heat capacity as a function of temperature for different sizes. Here in the case of deprotonated water clusters, and they see at the transition temperature, the heat capacity shoots up, but then at low temperatures, it's below the bulk value, which is the blue line. And sometimes it's something like 1/5 or so of the bulk value. So that's very strange. So question is, can we explain this? And it can be explained if we assume that we have a glass transition, because we do our caloric measurements not in the way that we have one cluster, we measure its energy, we heat it a little bit, we measure the energy again, we heat it a little bit, but we do it differently. We take a cluster out of the source, we cool it down to a certain temperature, we measure its energy. Then we take another cluster out of the source and cool it down to a different temperature and measure its energy. So because we cool it down to different temperatures, the cooling rate will be different, which means that if we go down to a very low temperature, then the cooling rate will be high, and this means we will actually end up in a higher energy structure. And if we cool down to a higher temperature, then there's more time for the clusters, and they can end up in a lower energy structure, which means that we get, due to this cooling rate dependence, we get a seeming reduction of the heat capacity, because all of these energies are more or less the same. Now, we wanted to test this by coming up with a very, very simple model. I mean, usually this melting transition in clusters are modeled with a two-level model. Just do a Boltzmann distribution between two different levels, the solid and the liquid one. Now we thought we have not two levels, but many, many, many. So we thought we must have some equilibrium distribution, which is should be reached at the end over many, many levels. But this probably this there's a, some kind of isomerization rate. So we thought that the population of the different isomers is actually reached with a rate. And for the rate, we just took a Arrhenius rate, temperature dependent. And then, of course, we have to say what the cluster temperature is. And this will slowly take on the trap temperature. And so we have a couple differential equations, which are easy to solve. And then we could simulate our experiment. We could simulate the caloric curves which we get out of the experiment. And the results are shown here for a certain choice of the parameters for the Arrhenius rate. And just two parameters were varied here. This is the storage time in the trap and the thermalization rate in the trap, which is mainly given by the pressure of the helium buffer gas. And we can see, depending on these parameters, we get a caloric curve, which is sometimes close to this lowest experimental curve which we got, and sometimes it's closer to this very strange deviating caloric curves which we got. And now we would like to really nail this down and show that there is this kind of glass transition. So we have to do this, show this variation in kind of a systematic manner, and therefore we are now building up an experiment. I should say we also see here in the simulation as in the experiment this vanishing heat capacity. It's just this because you reach different states if you cool with different rates. But we want to show this, and therefore we are building up an experiment where we have a two-trap experiment. So in the first trap we give the clusters a certain temperature, and then with the second trap we measure caloric curves. And with our simulations, we can see that depending on the trap temperature of this first trap, you get completely different caloric curves when you use the second trap for thermalization. So this would show that there's kind of a thermal memory in the clusters. It's you're far from ergodicity. Everything depends on the history, so the temperature changes the clusters have gone through. And with this, come to the end. So unlike the case of sodium clusters, where we saw a very nice first-order phase transition, in water clusters we see something strange, this kind of smeared-out transition, but definitely something is happening, some kind of softening of the cluster. We saw that the size dependence of this transition temperature leads to a convergence against the glass transition temperature of amorphous ice. Here we certainly have many different isomers in the small water clusters, which could say or could be used as a reason why we are seeing something with a which is like a glass transition. We have come up with a very simple model, which is at least somehow close to the experiment. Very soon we will have a thermal memory where we hopefully can nail down that this is a really special phase transition. And I thank you for your attention.